Hello everyone, we are here today with Dr. Roman Töppel.
Hello.
And we got a great Patreon question from Lukas König, and he asks, did regular soldiers lie as much in the memoirs as the generals did? Because after all, I mean, they were the guys who were being shot at.
Yeah.
So what is your take on this? Because you interviewed several.
Okay. In general, I think the generals were lying on a higher level, and they were, because they were facing the Nuremberg trials. And we know from recent research, Jens Brüggemann wrote a big thesis of doctorate about the Nuremberg trials and how the defendants and with their lawyers invented strategies to apologize the Wehrmacht and blaming Hitler. You know, we did a video on this. And so the generals, they had to think of their career, first of their lives. They were defending their lives, or they were facing long time imprisonment, and they had a much higher responsibility and much more to hide. And they wanted to, or many of them wanted to continue their career. So they were really keen on setting themselves in the best light, not to be punished and to be reinstated and to continue their career. And many of them managed to do so. You know, many Wehrmacht generals got on high NATO positions. And the ordinary soldiers, they wrote the memoirs for their families, and then they were published. Or they wrote for the comrades or just to remember. And they had not their careers in mind, you know, and they had not this high responsibility, and they had not to hide so much. Maybe they hid little things. I know that some of them hid also when they did something bad, really bad. They hid it in the memoirs too. But it's not on this high level that they faced like execution or a long time imprisonment. And so in general, I think the generals had a good reason to lie much more and on a higher level.
Yeah. So the incentives were quite different. And also what I think might have come to a certain degree in as well is the amount of burden that were upon them. Because, I mean, for me, the example is usually you have like an argument on YouTube in the comment section, and I'm also quite affected by this sometimes. And sometimes to admit a mistake, for some people, it's almost impossible. And you have these petty little mistakes about an argument or something. But the thing is, if you were a general, there were hundreds, thousands, 10,000 or 100,000 people that died because of your decisions or your mistakes. So even if you so the amount of mental rationalization that was going on is a complete different one, I assume, because if some people can't even admit that they made a mistake or read something wrong or have a different opinion, when you clearly show okay that can't make any sense, and these guys had like they lost the war and everything. And also, I mean, you look, even for instance, if you just look at that, if the other aspect as well, Germany was shrunk in power and everything and occupied and then partitioned and everything. So I think this huge amount of burden, the mental acrobatics from the psychological side, what must be going on, because we know of rationalization, how it changes some people, their opinion and everything. I think this also plays a huge aspect here, whereas the regular soldier, he also has to rationalize why, for instance, maybe a comrade died or something, but it's quite different between one comrade and a few hundred thousand or something.
I actually think of one example. It's really rare, but once I read in the memoirs of a ski jäger,
hunter would be the literal translation. Yeah. Mountain troops with skis.
Okay.
Or not necessarily mountain, just ski. Troops.
Ski troops, and he admitted he was awarded the Knight's Cross later, but he admitted, and I never had seen that before, that he said at some point he got a task. And he said, I failed. Ich versage, he writes. And he didn't write what he did wrong, but he said, I failed. And then he was put back and he was like in disgrace. He lost command and he was put in the officer reserve. And then they had so many officer losses that that a superior came and said, oh, I have need officers. And he said, I have only Flaschen. Yeah, I have only losers left. And he said, oh no, I know him. He's not a loser. Let's give him a shot. And he is, of course, he wants to make it up.
Rehabilitate himself.
And he really is really steadfast, and he got wounded and keeps on fighting, and he earns a Knight's Cross. But it's very interesting that he says, I failed. Yeah, and I've never seen this in the memoirs of a general, that he said, I failed or something like that. Yeah.
Yeah, and in this case, it probably because it had a happy ending to a certain degree. Okay, so it was this identity shift probably. Then it actually kind of makes more sense to admit it, I think.
Okay, that's a good point. But another example is what I mentioned in my book too. It's Hermann Breit, the commander of the 3rd Panzer Corps during the Kursk offensive. And I think we already did a video where I said this, everything went wrong in the area of the 3rd Panzer Corps. Everything went wrong, and it was it was bad tactical planning. And then this Hermann Breit has to write a paper, a study for the historical division, for the American historical division. And he writes, oh, everything went perfect and stuff. And of course, it's complete nonsense, but he writes it for the Americans, and he says everything went perfect. So he wants the Americans to think, oh, he's the perfect guy. Maybe we can use him against the Russians because it was all perfect. But in reality, everything went wrong. So you see this, the normal soldier, like this ski jäger, he didn't want to continue his career, and he didn't want to. There were no benefits. Yeah, but for the generals, there were really real benefits with lying. Came with lying. Yeah.
I mean, this, for instance, like that was. Recently, I talked to an Austrian who knew an ace who floated 262, and this ace, this Austrian ace, he hated Galland and Steinhoff. Mm-hmm. And Steinhoff, for instance, served in the NATO, and I mean there was some issues like what's going on personally, but this guy actually he didn't join the army or something, so he didn't have anything in there. So again, no incentives. So there's some completely different aspects around it. So this is what most memoirs are to a certain degree. PR, getting, for the channels around, for also defending themselves, rationalization to a certain degree. I mean, it would be really interesting if there's some psychological studies out there on this, mm-hmm. because I assume they have them for other elements, but I don't know if they have them actually for military commanders, mm-hmm. how they deal with all that stuff.
I don't know.
Because what's going on? Because generally, to the basic function of a memory, and I said this in other videos again already, but I can't bring it up often enough, and I think some people actually commented in the comment section, I studied this, and yeah, that's true. Your memory does not serve for you like a hard disk to collect all the data. Mm. Your memory is evolving all the time and basically fits to confirm your identity. Mm. So if you change your views in certain aspects, sometimes your memory applies and you review aspects of your memory differently, or you remember them differently. Again, also if you tell something, every time you tell something, it changes.
Yeah.
So this means sometimes those people don't really lie. They just maybe lie so often that now it becomes the truth in their mind, or because you have this cognitive dissonance and everything going on, that they actually really think that it's true. There's also the issue why I rarely use the word lie actually, because I'm aware this is like, this could have changed. I have some memory errors of my own that I remember that come across, but the thing is, I remember them, that I have them, and I even know the irony in noting that, because I could also be wrong. But for instance, they were like once I was entirely sure I ordered one book before another one. The good thing is I have data on this because I ordered both from Amazon, and I looked it up and it was the other way around. It was not about military history, but it was many years ago. It was about personal development. I was pretty sure, I started with this, and only then I went to that because the other thing didn't work out, and then I looked it up and no, it was the other way around.
Yeah.
But I had this view of myself, and I said, okay, my view of myself or my origin story in this area is actually incorrect.
And there's an expression, oral history. Oral history as a As a discipline, they say it's lebensgeschichtliche Erzählung, like life historical narrative, or I don't know.
That's a really hard word.
They then say, ask the guy about his life and what his life was. You ask him about the story of, he tells you and he put together for a narrative that his life makes sense for him.
Yeah.
And he wants you to believe in this picture, the story of his life. What really happened in his life, you will never know, but you have to be aware of when you do interviews. And there are different kinds of interviews. There are interviews where you just ask questions, and then there is this lebensgeschichtliches interview. Yeah, and you just say, okay, tell me about your blah. And then he keeps talking, you don't interrupt him or ask him a question, but he keeps talking. That's a lebensgeschichtliche Erzählung. Yeah.
So basically you ask a person about his interpretation of his life.
It's his narrative. Yeah. And then he can say, and we all do this. Okay, we have so many memories. I mean, we would be overloaded with it makes total sense that the brain says this is not important. That we have a contingency or a straight line that we can. So we put it together, our brain puts it together, that it all makes sense. So we can say this is my identity and I have this, I'm me because of this. And you could never say I ever remember everything that really happened, so it's perfectly normal.
I think Jordan Peterson, I think, once said, and this is from memory, so I might be wrong here, but he said some aspects, if you don't forget, can forget them, they serve still a function in your life. And I actually noticed myself, I'm very well known for remembering a lot of stuff people told me, and I told them on something. People often, when did you tell about this, and they say, yeah, this was there and there, and they were like, oh yeah. And but the issue is, I know I forget nearly everything from heavy metal concerts, and it's the irony. But the thing is, I just enjoy the heavy metal concert, and there's no bigger aspect that I need this information anymore. Therefore, I assume I forget everything because it just was an amazing time, and I remember. Okay. Mm-hmm. I saw Iron Maiden here in 1999 in Stuttgart, and I think it started with Churchill's speech and Aces High.
Yeah.
That's I remember, but besides that, and then but the other thing is gone, whereas other people remember a complete set list or something. But for me, that has no bigger bigger understanding.
This is psychologically proven too, that you only remember peaks. Really peak, but when they did interviews with World War One veterans, and they really spent 2 or 3 years in the trenches, and they couldn't remember anything because it was normality.
Yeah.
And so they only when something exceptional happened, then it says, oh, this.
Yeah.
But I mean, there are 1 year, let's say a couple of months when nothing happened, and it was for us, it would have been very exciting, and wow, and I'm in the war here in the trench. But for them, it was all day life, like I can't remember what I had for lunch yesterday because it's not important. Yeah. And for them it was only the peaks. Your memory remembers the peaks. Yeah.
I mean, this is the issue with war. It's 99 of the 9 time it's just total boredom, and 1% about is complete action, but it's also deadly action. So this is also the extreme contrast in war, where it's just boredom or it's just adrenaline to the top.
Yeah, you know the famous German book and the movie Das Boot by Lothar Günther Buchheim. And I'm not a big fan of that. We could do a video.
Yeah. I have a video already in mind.
I have a video in mind because I asked them when they were still alive, some U-boat commanders, what they thought about this man, his book and the film. But I read this book and it's really interesting that you really get a bit of the idea that most of the time it was just pure boredom. Yeah. When they were in the Atlantic for 6 or 8 weeks, and then maybe if they sank really well, good success, maybe they sank 5 or 6 ships, but that's 5 or 6 days when there is really action going on and this is excitement. But for the guys under deck, you know, it's just, and he describes it quite good in this book, Das Boot, it's sheer boredom, 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 yeah.
And basically, how many people can look out a periscope? Basically, 2 or 3 on the deck watch. So basically, you have like at most 10% that see anything. The other guys are just in the machinery area, which is just, I guess, stinky. And
in the happy times, as they called it, when they were not this aerial superiority and not planes, allied planes everywhere, they sunk a single freighter, and then they had time, and the commander was a nice guy. He said, okay, everyone can come to the bridge and have a look at this target and the sinking. But this later on in the war wasn't just not possible during these convoy battles. Yeah, they had to disappear as fast. So some of the crew members never saw what happened, or never saw a sunk freighter or a sinking freighter. And for them, it's just a horrible life in a tin can. Yeah. So that's what we underestimate, because in the movies they show, fighting and
the games, you have time compression and suddenly you're at the convoy. Yeah.
And Rudolf von Ribbentrop, a famous German war veteran, it was the son of the Reich foreign minister. He said in an interview, the thing I that bothered me most in war, you would think it's artillery or whatever, is the lack of sleep. I was always tired. It was not that you expect the Soviet tanks or artillery or whatever. He said the thing that really got me most was I was always tired.
That's actually really interesting to notice that even nowadays soldiers usually they can fall asleep immediately. Because I remember when I did my boot camp, or then my national service regularly, and usually when a car started moving and they were not driving, everyone fell asleep immediately. Yeah. And at one point when I had my internship at the Military Research Center, we went one day to Berlin, and one of the officers was responsible for me, and we were three interns. And he started talking, he was sitting in the front, he talked like 3 minutes, and then suddenly he fell asleep, and we back there were joking because what happened? And one of them was also saying, yeah. And I said, yeah, that's completely normal, even nowadays, because soldiers are basically, lack of sleep is still a thing. And
even I had a rather calm army time. I served my army time too, but I also remember this lack of sleep. And once we were cleaning weapons, there was a large table, and all everything was in this floor. We were cleaning weapons, and at some point I was like, and then some NCO came and, and I woke up and gave him a really nasty look. So yeah, lack of sleep is maybe the thing.
It's a military trait usually.
Yeah, the greatest thing that can happen when they say, oh, we'll give you 2 days leave or you can sleep, and that's a blank.
I remember I could fall asleep on the back end, I don't know what's the correct term, of my SDG 77, no, 74? SDG 44?
I don't know.
The Steyr AOG, because, yeah. So, well, I think we covered that one.
Okay, thank you very much. It was more about us than about Wehrmacht, but...
Thank you for watching. See you next time. Bye.
Thank you. See you.